Hello, everyone. It's Anika Rahman here. Welcome so much to our session today. I hope you found that song inspiring, and I know you will find our conversation today inspiring. I want to begin by thanking all of you for attending. We have a global audience today, and I also want to thank our speakers, Yanar, Charo, and Joy, as well as all of my colleagues at MADRE, particularly Yifat. I have a long list of people I will thank at the end of this session with us. I am a newly joined board member at MADRE, and I joined MADRE because of its work, its critical work in highlighting feminist organizing as we deal with what I think are the two greatest challenges in the world, the issue of equality, inequality, equity, and the climate crisis. I believe that the answer to many of our current solutions is to come together collaboratively to organize, and that is the only way to address these monumental challenges we face in the world. For those of us who are in the United States, of course, this is a especially tense time as we head into an election, the outcomes of which we can only hope for, but remain uncertain. For our colleagues around the world, we understand that this is a terrible time for all of us, actually, as we deal with a pandemic and life in a way that's so different from anything we've had before. And I know that we all need points of light and hope, and I hope that this conversation and being involved in movements presents that. I'd just like to share a little bit about myself and tell you that I am a champion for human rights, social justice, particularly for women. My life's work is in advancing equality and justice and in dealing with climate and sustainable development issues. As a child, I saw war. I saw the War of Independence of Bangladesh, and I was a refugee. I came to the US at the age of 18. And so I bring many cultures, many different experiences to bear, but they all reinforce to me the importance of equality and justice, and the importance of continuing our work for a better world. So I'm just gonna now also tell you a little bit more. I hope that the title of this session, Defending Democracy, inspires us all, because we know that women's rights and democracy are linked and interconnected. There is no true democracy or equality without women's liberation and participation. We are more than half the world's people. But beyond that, to defend democracy and defeat the rise of authoritarianism, both in the United States and elsewhere in the world, we must learn from the strategies of successful feminist movements around the world. We can draw strength and greater strength and inspiration from our colleagues around the world. And I also want to remind us about what we mean by democracy. It is not just about voting, because we know that everybody has not had the ability to vote. It is the right to participate in shaping our destiny, our nations, and our futures. That is what democracy means to me. It gets highlighted in electoral politics, but we know it is an ongoing struggle in many parts of the world and in most parts of the world. And so I think also democracy is a special meaning for women and other marginalized and oppressed communities around the world, because we have not been equal participants in democracy, right? Our voices have not been heard. So I hope that this conversation today inspires us to learn from the wisdom of those struggles and to defend our vision of democracy, the future we want for ourselves. To me, in defending democracy, nonviolent feminist organizing makes all the difference. A hallmark of women-led feminist organizing is nonviolence. I know it works. I believe we all know it works. That it is the only and the most successful way at confronting autocracy and repression. What's more, democracy campaigns with significant women's representation tend to be larger and ultimately more successful. When so many people mobilize, it becomes harder for governments to delegitimize the movement as fringe or extremist. The work of the people you're about to hear today reveal two things. One, that we are laying democratizing groundwork every day through our work on peace, rights, and justice. Two, that there are hard-won lessons we can activate now and through these uncertain days ahead, work and learn from our partners worldwide. This is one of the reasons I support MADRE, because it highlights this work, partnership with grassroots women worldwide, as a way to illuminate the way forward. Before we jump into the discussion, a few announcements. This event is closed captioned. To activate that function, please click, I'm reading, at the bottom of your Zoom screen. At the end of the session, we will reserve time for Q&A and we welcome your questions. Please click the Q&A button to send them to us. Also, bios for each of the speakers will be available in a link in the chat box. So it is with great pleasure that I introduce our first speaker, Yanar Mohammed. You will see her bio in the link. Yanar is a prominent Iraqi peace activist and women's rights defender, both in her home country of Iraq and worldwide. She founded the Organization of Women's Freedom in Iraq, OWFI, in 2003. So rather than take up time introducing an incredible activist and leader, I'd like to just hand the Zoom floor over to Yanar. Thank you.
Thank you, Anika, for the nice introduction. My sisters in MADRE know this history, but I will make it very brief for those who are seeing me for the first time. The year 2003 was a major turn in my life because I was living in a country that was occupied by external powers led by the US. And we all as women at some point in our life, we have to face the fact that we did not want to be political all our lives, but then politics came and it turned around everything for us. It took away all the rights and all the humble but nice living that we had. The politics got involved in everything, in our bodies, in what I'm allowed to wear and not wear, in what I study, in what I do for work, who I marry, who I don't want to marry. So all of a sudden, in that year, I had to face the fact that this cannot go on. I cannot allow some major powers to come and enslave me in their own ways that they might call democratic, but it's not democracy. It's not a feminist democracy when somebody comes and puts rules of how to turn your body into a tool for reproducing babies, you not having the rights to say anything, and you are surprised that you are not the only one that's subjugated, that there are groups around the country that get subjugated, whether for the color of their skin or because they belong to this religion or that sect, and they are being oppressed, put in prison. And at some point, you think that not being political was the good choice when it turned out to be the worst choice, because then you are able to be enslaved by anybody who comes along and decides to take away your rights. So in Iraq, we sat together, a few women, and we decided, what can we do about this? And the idea was that let's call it an organization, make it about our freedom. And in this part of the world, we call it Organization of Women's Freedom in Iraq. And we see what women will need 1 year after another. And we decided first that there needs to be a shelter for us who are being persecuted by our families, by the tribe, and then by the state that allows our families to physically abuse us or to kill us in the name of honor. So we started it with shelters. Then we began to speak to different groups like the Afro-Iraqis. We began to speak to LGBT people. And all of a sudden, the Iraqi uprising starts in the year 2019, and we find that we are in the front line doing the organizing for others in the Iraqi Tahrir Square. We set up our tent, put our slogans, and we decided that the democracy that we want will be about us, not about some abstract rights for rich people sitting somewhere, and we don't know what they do with our lives. So we started to talk about it. We held the microphones and talked, and we began to organize however we could. And you get surprised that under a democracy, a government will still send you people who are armed. They call them militias. They say we have nothing to do with them. It's not the government, but eventually these armed groups, they come, they look for you, they might detain you, they disrupt the organizing work that you do, and you have to be ready for all of these things. So one of the things that was done against OFI is that, OFI is the acronym for Organization of Women's Freedom in Iraq. One of the things that they did against us is that the government filed in a lawsuit against our organization. And you would be surprised that the reason that they put on the lawsuit is that we shelter women from honor-related issues, trying to call us honorless, and that we defend and support LGBTs in a way to try to make their lives as normalized as possible in the community. Well, we looked at the subpoena and at the documents of the court, and we thought, what? They want to take us 1,000 years back in time. They want us to live in those times when a woman did not have a right to choices in her life. And when I think of it, and I see the news over the television and what's happening in the state, and who was elected to the, do you call it the Supreme Court? I see that the same is happening. The laws might be turning against the women's rights in the US. A president might come that will be totally undemocratic. And then what is to do? We all have to be political. We all have to be on guard. We all have to be ready to organize, not only with women who are like-minded like us, but we need to broaden that organizing as much as we can and to find the most commonalities that bring us all together and not those things that separate us from each other. In Iraq today, the militias came down, on the 25th, the militias came down onto the Tahrir Street and they detained—
1 minute left, Yanar.
Sure. They detained 300 demonstrators because they were asking for the end of a corrupt government, for the end of a despotic government, a government that had killed 700 demonstrators last year. So we are still there. We are still organizers. And it's always good to know when to lay low and when to speak out, but to think of it as a continuous struggle. It might be a lifetime thing, but then again, all the rights that anybody enjoyed were worked for and was organized for by generations before us. I see no other way to do it. We continue to do it in Iraq in spite of the legal harassment, in spite of the militia harassment, and we are doing the outreach more and more. So this is what we do. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Yanar. That was really, for me, a trailer, and I hope that we hear from you more about how you've handled the retaliation against your organizing by the government. I hope that's something we can address in the Q&A. So thank you, Yanar. It is my great pleasure next to introduce colleague Charo to speak. And Charo, as you can see in the chat, is an Afro-Colombian human rights leader and the International Advocacy and Outreach Director for PCN. She played a key role in the peace process in Colombia, serving on the Gender Committee of the Ethnic Commission to ensure that the voices and rights of Afro-Colombians were included in the peace accord. Charo, over to you now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. I bring greetings from our ancestral territories of Lajoy and freedom. I want to take a minute to give a little bit of context. I'm presenting here the experience of my organization, the Black Communities Process in Colombia, and in some aspects, experience of the Black Afrodescendant people in Colombia. First, just to say that Colombia is a country, the third country in the Americas that has the largest Afrodescendant population. It's a 44 million people country, and we are 20%, although census always managed to undermine those numbers. So from 2005 being 10%, we are now 3% accordingly with the census, which gives you some sense of how we are in this place. Colombia has been in a context of internal armed conflict from since 1995, from five decades, but since 1995, violence exacerbated in our ancestral territories, Black Afrodescendant territories. And especially when paramilitary forces supported by a right-wing government encroach our communities and start a period of blood and terror. We, as Black Afrodescendant people and women, have suffered massacres, killings. Many women and men leaders have been assassinated, internal displaced of over 1.5 million of our people, half of them women. Women have survived rape, killing, disappearance, forced recruitment of their children, girls and boys. There is no clear account, for instance, of the number of rape, assassination, torture, dismembering, disappearance, forced prostitution, recruitment, trafficking of our women and girls. And behind this context is the state, multinationals, national industry, drug dealers, guerrilla paramilitaries, economic interest on territories that are strategic because of the resources, natural resources, but also the location. So we are not only victims of this internal armed conflict, but also victims of capitalist development. And of course, linked to that structural racism. So I would like to present what we have learned from this context in our 27 years of organizing a political struggle and resistance. First of all, we have learned that we are not against a particular government, or we are not against a particular guerrilla group or paramilitary or armed group. We confront and must be aware of us, that we are confronting a system. It is a capitalist, racist, patriarchal, oppressive system in a country born and raised on our indigenous and our blood. And it continued to be so. And we also have learned that our best opportunity has been organizing political education of our bases, particularly women, and continuous nurturing of the sense of identity and belonging. It's very important for us to know who we are, where we come from, and where we want to be as women and as Afro-descendant women. There must be a sense of belonging with a specific material space to be, and that's why wherever people is displaced, it always rebuild territoriality. So in those areas, we rebuild culture, ancestral practices, bring back our ancestral knowledges to rebuild and keep that sense of belonging and identity and being part of something. And precisely from that sense of community as a need, we have understood that our struggle is not the only one, and it's not only ours, our struggle, that our problems are part of a bigger global system of oppression, and that we cannot do it by ourselves. We must build reciprocal solidarity and alliances with others and create a stronger front of struggle. In our experiences, alliances with indigenous people, for instance, with other sectors, international allies at different levels, always looking for some kind of leverage that give us some point of advantage is key. So we are always looking for ways to keep the government accountable in some way, and these alliances and this reciprocal solidarity and these forms of solidarity are very important. It is not always easy. However, you know, we understand that there are internal contradictions, but we take the chance because it's only together and building up these forces that we can confront these powers that are so strong. One element that we have learned in all this horror that we have to live is that we must confront, resist, and defeat fear. And the indifference and sense of normality and insensitivity that systematic and intensive periods of terror, violence, and impunity can build up on people. We have what has helped us to overcome this fear is feeling that we are not alone, is creating support around us, providing visibility to our situations, getting others on board from letters of support, from campaigns, signing on, joint mobilizations, strikes. Our goal is always to stay visible and being surrounded in support. And finally, I will have to say there is also other resources that in the middle of so much horrible things that people have to endure, we have women come always with initiatives to heal, to care, to protect. Traditional ancestral knowledge has been very, very important in processes of healing and keeping sane. Our understanding that others depend on us, from us, and that we depend on others doesn't allow us to succumb under the stress and depression that is there. Believe me, it's always there. But there is something, some kind of force beyond us that keep us grounded and strong. And that beyond us is that sense of community and belonging to something. And so I will end up saying that using the words of one of my sisters, Sophia, that as the operation gets updated, as it is getting very updated, they always come with something new, resistance must be updated. And it's the way that we live and we are, how we are living, that tell us how to update that resistance. So we must pay attention to how we are living and what we are doing to live in dignity, to being able to support the resistance in times where things get so wrong, so confused, and so dangerous. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Charo. You were right on time. Thank you, and thank you for inspiring us. I know you talked about how to usher in mass participation in protests by building an inclusive, diverse movement, especially from your perspective as an Afro-Colombian. So I hope that we will hear more about this. It is my pleasure now to introduce our next speaker, Joy. Again, the chat function should be highlighting Joy's CV. Joy is the international president of the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, known as WILPF, and former president of WILPF Nigeria. Joy formed and chaired the Women's Situation Room of Nigeria, which works to ensure that all elections in Nigeria are peaceful and include the participation of women and youth. These are all very appropriate topics, and we hope, Joy, of course, that we will learn from your experiences. We hope that you will also in your presentation talk to us about the lessons on how to identify the key warning signs and effective strategies to respond to the possibility of electoral violence, especially as we approach this issue in the United States. So thank you, Joy, and over to you.
Thank you very much, Anika, and thank you, MADRE, for this opportunity to share my experiences. The Women's Situation Room Nigeria. Yes, please. Hello. Hello.
All good. Thank you. We can hear you.
Are you hearing me?
Yes, please proceed, Joy. Thank you.
Okay. The Women's Situation Room Nigeria was formed as a result of the inequalities. Okay, great. All right. Okay. The Women's Situation Room Nigeria was formed as a result of our intention to ensure that women participate substantively in the peace and security of Nigeria. So part of what we do is to observe the electoral process and also with particular emphasis on the election proper. So we look at three key critical components, and that's inclusivity, accountability, and also participation of women in the elections.
I lost Joy.
Yeah, I think we lost sound overall. I know that we're just having some technical issues, which we will resolve. While we are waiting for Joy, I think... Joy
okay.
Is back.
All right. Okay, the network is horrible here. So the three key critical components that we do observe in elections from a gendered perspective is accountability, inclusivity, and also the participation of women in the process. So we really focus on the election proper, looking at how all this play out. And that for us tells us the quality of the elections. Now, in the last elections, 2019, one of the key things we did was to set up a physical situation room at the national, the Federal Capital Territory of Nigeria, which is in Abuja, where we also had state observatories in the different states across Nigeria. And all these states feed into the national hub, where we analyze the information coming in, and then we look at the trend. What this does is that it gives us a key indicator of what is happening where and what and which states are the hot flash points. Now, some of the early warning indicators, I would really say, in elections are when you look at political tensions, you also see discontent, you also look at lack of inclusivity, and then you also look at lack of accountability. Then, of course, some other emergencies that may be playing out in the country's context. So in Nigeria, of course, we know how the situation is. Nigeria is the largest country in Africa, and it has over 200 million people, of which women make up nearly half of the population. But women are still disenfranchised from participating in key political positions and also in key decision-making positions as well. And so that is what makes the women's situation in Nigeria very critical to have, because it is a way of moving women from the informal space into the formal space, where we participate actively in the peace and stability of Nigeria. Now, one other thing that is very interesting for me as the convener of the Women's Situation Room, looking at the forthcoming American elections, is to look at the way things are playing out in the American society, which for us already putting out a whole lot of red flags, which we also need to start watching and having mitigation plans. So we need to start looking at effective strategies for mitigating against electoral violence. Unfortunately, the American election has gone the other way, which for us, because the American election is one election that is watched all over the world, and for Nigeria, plays a very key role in our own political system. So we really follow the elections actively. And so the key indicators I mentioned earlier on as warning signals are already very present in the American pre-election environment. And so it's very important that feminists begin to act and begin to close rank, form very strong coalitions to provide mitigating strategies. Some of the key things that I've found that works in the elections is, looking at our experiences in Nigeria, is having a very strong coalition or network responsible for moderating the peace talks and disseminating information. And this is so because the coalition or network, we have clout, it's a trusted one, it's a credible one, and then people know where to go to for reliable information. You know, very key in spreading this. We've seen that happen within the Nigeria experience. And so looking at the last election where we had in Lagos, just before the major elections, there was this ethnic coloration of the elections. And it was only the Women's Situation Room Nigeria that had that foresight of being prepared and going right into the scene to talk to the major stakeholders. So dialogue is very key. We need to be ready as women peace activists to dialogue and to bring everyone to the table. So another, to round up and in conclusion, borrowing and then adopting those experiences is very helpful as a preventive strategy for electoral violence. And so I think that there's a whole lot of lessons to learn from the Nigeria experience for the American. And it's also important that we talk to one another, and then we have a coalition that is responsible for disseminating information and collating information. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Joy, and thank you for being patient with all the networking issues and the problems that we're all facing. So thank you. It is now my great pleasure, absolute pleasure, to introduce Yifat. I'm sure most of you, of course, know Yifat. She is a personal pleasure to work with and one of the draws to MADRE for me. She is a lifelong promoter of human rights and is the executive director of MADRE and leads its combined strategy of community-based partnerships and international human rights advocacy. Under Yifat's leadership, MADRE has enabled thousands of local women's activists worldwide to survive and recover from war, climate breakdown, and their aftermath. And I know that Yifat is going to tie together all of the previous presentations by our fabulous colleagues and talk about how they're applicable in the US context as we seek to respond to fraudulent electoral moves by a president that I have a lot of issues with, the potential for election violence, and more broadly, an extended period of disorientation and uncertainty because this is long-term in the United States. So without further ado, Yifat.
Thank you, Anika, and thank you, Joy, and Charo, and Yanar, and thank you to everybody on the other side of your computer screen who's joined us for the conversation. I feel like I have to just start by naming how crazy it feels that we are having an election in this country that is essentially a referendum on authoritarianism in the United States. It feels like the whole climate around this election has been one more of these sort of like cascading crises that we've been dealing with all year, the pandemic and the burning of the West Coast and this deep economic pain for so many people in this country. And all of these things are expressions of these systems that we have all known our whole lives that are right now in a state of collapse. And we have to remember, I think, that this time of collapse can also be a time of transformation and a time to recognize what Charo was talking about, the ways that we are all connected, that interdependence that you just spoke of, Charo, you know, even connected to people on the other side of the world. And I think in the US, we are seeing right now what happens when people deny that connectivity and believe that, you know, we're all separate from each other, separate from nature. That is how we get that kind of toxic individualism that has left so many people alienated and open to authoritarianism. Hannah Arendt taught more than 70 years ago that the breeding ground for fascism is loneliness. which is why I think one of the most important things we can do right now is exactly what you have done by joining this conversation. And it is to overcome isolation and to connect with people who deeply remind you of the kind of world that you want to live in. And for me, those people are MADRE partners and allies like Joy and Yanar and Charo and Anika, who are working with us to make sure that people have the basics, food and clean water, healthcare, freedom from violence, the shelters that Yanar spoke of. And that through that process of meeting these basic needs, people are also building power to come together to create lasting social change. That's the work of these women. And I think it holds so many vital lessons for those of us in the United States right now. So like Anika said, I'm gonna try to sort of highlight three of those lessons for us to tee up some conversation. You know, Joy was speaking about electoral violence. And I think we know that we need to be alert to the threat of white supremacist violence around this election. But there's also a real possibility of violence from the state. And one of the things that we need to be clearly on the lookout for in the coming days and weeks, I think, is any attempt by Trump to sideline those military leaders who were opposed to using the army to put down protests this summer and to replace those people with loyalists. So if we start to hear rumblings in the media about the defense secretary being fired or General Milley getting marginalized, that's the kind of red flag that Joy was just alerting us to be on the lookout for. And if there is electoral violence, the experience of women around the world shows us that the best antidote is going to be building resilient social networks, the kind that will enable us to come together to prevent violence from spreading and to protect people who are targeted. The kind of networks that you were talking about, Charo, that the Women's Situation Room in Nigeria also has worked to build. Now, we all hope that that is not going to be needed, but it's important to strengthen those kinds of activist networks because we're going to continue to need them no matter the outcome of this election. And I think after this conversation, we'll be able to share some resources that include some on how to build and fortify these kinds of networks in our own communities. The second lesson that I want to highlight is that if we do face a right-wing power grab in this country, which we all know is likely, it's everyday people in great numbers who are going to make the difference. Not leaving it up to lawyers or courts or the leadership of the Democratic National Committee, but as Yanar was talking about, tactics like demonstrations and general strikes and civil disobedience, that's what's going to make the difference. And we have seen that not only in Iraq, but in Bolivia, in Mali, in Burkina Faso, in many, many places. And we know from these experiences that it's going to be critical for those kinds of protests to remain nonviolent, not just as a moral imperative, because as Anika was saying, we know that nonviolence is almost twice as likely to be effective in winning pro-democracy campaigns. So we can have those debates about the role of violence, but ultimately from a tactical perspective, it's the best option. And we've seen that also in countries from Serbia to the Gambia to the Philippines and elsewhere. And we've seen how women's leadership is so critical to that kind of mass popular resistance, not just because it is overwhelmingly tends to be nonviolent, but because as you've just heard described, it makes space for the greatest number of people to actually participate. And we've seen that in the work that the three of you are leading, but also in Sudan last year, in Palestine in the first Intifada. I think it's unfolding in Thailand right now. It's a critical piece of any pro-democracy movement. And finally, you know, we know from our partners that the most volatile moment we're likely to face is after the election, but before the outcome is determined, right? That's what we're seeing right now in Belarus, where another pro-democracy movement is being led by women. And during that interim time, if Trump declares victory before all the votes are counted or tries to stop the count, we're gonna need to call that what it is, which is a coup, and not engage in the kind of US exceptionalism that says that that can't happen here because it's the United States. Because if we do face a coup, it will be critical to mobilize not just nonviolently and inclusively, but also quickly. And we can share some really great research that shows how the most successful pro-democracy movements are the ones that can stand up a campaign within hours and win within days or like literally a couple of weeks. The last lesson I want to highlight is that our work together is about so much more than securing this election. It's really about figuring out how we build back from systemic collapse, not by recreating the conditions that brought on this collapse, but by inventing what's gonna replace these failing systems that are kind of going down in flames all around us, right? Including how we invent regenerative new forms of democracy. And when we're in that mode of deeply knowing that our work, our activism, our philanthropy is producing what's gonna come next, then we don't need to be so fearful about the future because we're creating it, right? Charo spoke about the importance of confronting fear. And ultimately, what we need to defend democracy is the same thing that we need to confront the pandemic and the breakdown of the climate and so many of the other crises that we're facing right now. It's community. It's those resilient social networks that enable us to protect each other from want and harm and join together to build the kind of society that we want. That's what we support our grassroots partners to do, which is to build local grassroots organizations that are that infrastructure for resilience. You know, Audre Lorde says, without community, there is no liberation. And I think our understanding of community has to be embodied and local, right? Who's bringing you soup if you get COVID? Who are you shielding if riot cops show up at a protest? But our understanding of community also has to be international, because the big crises that we're facing in the world, including the attack on democracy, are international. And so we have to find our people in this world. We have to find those people who are in solidarity with us, people like Joy and Yanar and Charo and Anika. And then we can come together through MADRE to create this community of feminist activists, women and men, who are advancing the vision that we share of how we want the world to be, and using this time of extreme disruption to create the kind of solutions that we've actually needed all along. So I want to thank everybody on the call who's helped us to build this community over the last 37 years. And welcome those of you who are joining us now. It's the perfect time. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Yifat. Thank you for those great points. It's been so inspirational. And I want to thank our speakers, not only for the extraordinary work you do under very difficult and trying situations, but also for sharing your insights with us about how we can apply these lessons and experiencing to what we're all living through, which is almost surreal, unreal, given the pandemic that we're also in the midst of. I would just like to just say I really take to heart the point made about US exceptionalism, which is a fallacy. It always has been, given the shallowness of, I think, democracy in the United States, at least, where historically Black communities, indigenous communities, and so many of us didn't have the ability to vote or participate in this democracy. I also want to just really say how inspiring it is for us all to realize that this is a long-term process beyond any one election, and we are really part of building a new vision of democracy. I really appreciate that, Yifat. So as a new board member of MADRE, I couldn't be more proud to represent the work of the incredible women on this call and the many like them who are not in this particular call today, who are doing life-saving work for women, girls, and their communities at the front lines of feminist activism and organizing. However the political winds blow, because this is a long-term engagement on redefining democracy, I find comfort in knowing that I'm standing with an organization like MADRE and its partners as they work to achieve a world we all want to live in. To moderate the next part, which is the Q&A, I'd like to hand this over to Diana, MADRE's Policy and Strategic Engagement Director. Diana, I'm sure there are some great questions and I can't wait to hear them. So over to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anika, and thank you to all the speakers and everyone who's here with us today. So yes, we do have some questions coming in. I welcome anyone who hasn't submitted your questions yet to please throw them into the mix. Anika, if you want to take the prerogative to throw in any of your own as well as the moderator, I would welcome you to do that. And one question that we wanted to share is a follow-up, because I think that we've had some great lessons learned that have been shared in the conversation so far. And one of the dominant strains of the conversation has been the value of people power, and that to defend democracy, we're going to need to mobilize in big numbers and quickly, as Yifat was saying. And that was something that you pointed out as well, Yanar. You know, you said in your comments that we need to be ready, we need to organize together, and not only with like-minded people. So I wonder if you could speak to how, you know, how do you do that? You know, when you think about people who maybe have never been in a protest before, who've never taken to the streets before, how do you create that space for people to feel welcome and to feel like there's a space for them in our mobilizations?
Yeah, I would love to do that. I will take an example from real life. In November 2019, the demonstrations in the Tahrir Square of Baghdad and in the other cities began to get so angry because the government began to send the militias to kill the demonstrators, especially the young men who were on the front lines. So we went in there, we set up two tents, we took our slogans about freedom and equality for everybody. And we said, we're not moving from here until we see a result. And all of a sudden, all the young men's families began to come to the square, and all around the country, we were surprised in 2 or 3 days' time, the numbers were at least 1 million in the streets. And when it reaches to 1 million in the streets, what else can the government do? The government of Adel Abdel Mahdi, that was responsible of the killing of the demonstrators, resigned. On that day, we lived the euphoric joy of our life, that for the first time in our lives, we see that the power of the people is bringing a result. That government resigned, and of course, everybody in the state or in the ruling parties, they sat together and they began again to put some new conspiracies of how to manage this. And they're still trying, but not very successful at it. So that day of all days, when the government resigned because 1 million of us were in the streets, is a day that I will never remember. And the second thing that I would like to mention is that when we get together, when you support us, when women support each other, we look at, sometimes you are in the streets and sometimes you're on your desktop and looking at your reports and papers. We looked at our papers and we did some math and we found out that Aufi has sheltered and saved 1,000 women during our work of 17 years. 1,000 women were able to keep their lives, and not only that, but came into our shelters that are places of transformation from a victim into a feminist that stands up against her oppressors, against the government, and becomes part of that struggle. So 1,000 women saved in Iraq is something that we are proud of, that MADRE should be proud of, and all the partners that supported the struggle around the world. Women can be a very strong player in political changes. And when they are out in the streets and they say it out loud to everybody, enough is enough. The despots cannot stay in place. The oppressors cannot stay in place. The women haters cannot stay in place. Like today in our parliament in Iraq, they were discussing an article in the law of how to deprive a mother of the right to take care of her children who are less than 5 years old. So you can't, they continue to work against women, these state gatekeepers. Mm-hmm. And one last thing I would like to add, it is not enough to say that we are only working for the elections, because once a new government administration comes along and they feel very comfortable that everything's going fine and everybody thinks of them as the liberators, the bad things will also come along. We have to be out there always with our eyes open, organizing, and we actually have to rule ourselves. Just we tell every woman that comes to our shelter that when you become strong, you will have to observe your self-determination, and nobody should observe it for you. So in that—
Right, and I think that your work speaks to the ways that we're able to be networked together, right? And think that's a point that Yifat was making as well, that everything that we're doing is about building community, about building resilience together, about building those collective ties that now are needed in a moment of mobilization.
It was very important to connect all the Tahrir squares of the Iraqi cities to uprise in the same moment. Mm-hmm. And that's when a million people came to the streets, and it succeeds. Mm-hmm. Can succeed with the willpower behind it.
There's a question in the chat too about, and I know that a lot of the speakers have faced this, where you're confronted with violent retaliation, right? Even though your organizing maybe is nonviolent itself, the response is violent. And so how do you maintain that commitment to nonviolence in those moments? And what is the strategy for that? And I open the question to Charo, to Yanar, to Joy, to anyone who'd like to respond to that one.
Well, I would like to, oops.
Charo, why don't you go first and then, yeah.
Thank you, I'm sorry. In this kind of situation, especially if it's a massive mobilization, it is hard to keep nonviolent acts in the middle. However, there is another question I saw in the Q&A panel that is like how to keep these forces that want to be violent isolated, right? Some way is to create like vigilance within the movement, no? Sectors that are therefore being vigilant on keeping this elements of that wants to be in violence isolated. Sometimes it's possible, and there have been experience about that, even in the United States, on talking them down. I think Puerto Rico just had that experience recently. Just being able to talk to them down and isolate them by special groups that are used for keeping these acts aside from the majority of people. I'm trying to be brief because of the time, but I think I would like to address a few other things I saw in the questions, if you don't mind, just briefly. And as the first question of how to keep people that is new engaged, that comes engaged. I think when people come to a mobilization, like the songs that we just saw in the United States, people is coming because there is something, a message that called them on their dignity, on their responsibility, their social responsibility with what is happening. And as long as those messages keep coming up, I mean, the movement continued to put there the messages that resonate on everybody, people is going to stay. And one very important element, people is going to be feeling relevant. But very important element that we have experienced here is when you keep the sense of dignity, you know, as Yanar was saying, instead of victim, someone that with agency that is there because you saw and because had something to defend and to be up there for, people just stay. There is no even need to be doing anything extra. But the messages and the components of what is presented and the messages have to be very consistent. And that is where I bring the element of understanding that we are not against Trump. We are not against my right-wing president and their paramilitary forces. We are against a system. And what we need to address on those messages is what is that system doing to us, and how is that system taking from us our dignity, our agency, our humanity, and what we are doing on the streets is bringing that back. And I think that that always, you know, that's why I always mention the identity and the sense of belonging, because those are the things that always mobilize people. Mm-hmm. There was something else I wanted to address, but I don't want to take much time from other speakers.
Well, just speaking of the time, I think there's a lot of really great questions coming in. So if folks have the flexibility to stay on for just a few more moments, I think we'll have time to dive into some of those. You know, one question that came up is about how do you mobilize in the face of COVID-19, you know, in this time of social distancing? You know, what are some of the things that you all have been able to do in order to sort of modify your tactics as needed to do the work that's necessary?
Yeah, I can take this. This has really called for a lot of alternative solutions in mobilizing. So moving over from just the physical to the digital space. So one of the things we did amongst the communities where we work in is to create different platforms where we can interact with them. And we do know that network is an issue here. So we also looked at using SMS. You'll be surprised how viral SMS messages can go. And that has really worked. So you send a message and it just goes viral to the different community of women that you want to mobilize. And this is where it's also very important to have clear communication, especially when you're not doing in-person mobilizing, you're using digital channels. It's very important that you keep your messaging very clear and straight to the point, so that it's very it's easy for the different subgroups of women to understand what you're saying and to take action based on that. Documentation, I can't overemphasize the need for documentation in mobilization, because you need to document the process. You need to also have a way of looking at what has worked and what did not work so that you can tweak it a little bit. So we've been able to, especially when we saw the exacerbation of gender-based violence within Nigeria, we use a lot of digital channels. You know, we use SMS, phone calls, and you'd be amazed at how many persons responded to that and how quickly we're able to mobilize women across to report violence, to take actions based on that, and we're able to generate disaggregated data. So I would say look at alternative digital methods of mobilizing. You mustn't always do in-person mobilization.
Charo Yanar?
In terms of COVID, you people mobilized recently in the middle of the pandemic, and everybody was on the streets with COVID or whatever, right? I think that the message of keeping it safe, keeping the mask, providing as possible, you know, the cleaning, certain distancing, it is very important. But the reality is that, you know, if you have to be on the street mobilizing, that's what it is. So basics is just keeping what we know that is the most important element to keep it safe, you know, the mask, the sanitizer, and trying the best to keep some distancing. I think that information constantly repeating is important for people to keep it in mind. To me, and for what I saw in your own experience a few months ago, people is very conscious of it. People that goes to the street to defend their rights, I'm not talking about the other side, but this side of ours, is very conscious about it, taking care of the other as we take care of ourselves. So I don't see that people is going to have problem using the mask and keeping certain elements of care to prevent what could generate a massive mobilization in the middle of COVID. But it is, you know, at the end it is what it is, and all we need to know is that when we take the streets, we take own responsibility for our own care and for the care of the others around us. That's a principle. It's a principle that needs to be encouraged constantly.
So there's a few questions that I'm gonna kind of bundle together, and we can see how folks might wanna respond to them. One, there was a question about men's, actually a few questions about men's participation and working in partnership with men and boys in this work. There was also a question about, this is related to what you were just mentioning, Charo, Black Lives Matter and the movement for Black Lives and the uprising that we've seen and how that sort of, how your work has related to it, or how you've seen women of color or feminist leadership in that space. And then the third question, another big news item that we've seen recently is about the policy and the impacts of the policy of child separation that the Trump administration has engaged in, and how that, you know, what response, you know, we might be able to mobilize as a movement to that. So three different questions, but maybe Yifat, if you want to address the one on child separation first and how that fits into this picture.
Sure, thank you for the question. Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, I think all of us share the same just sort of sense of like moral repugnance at that policy. And I hope that we will look back and that will be like the darkest hour ever of the Trump years, and then that those years are ending. But even if that's true, I think it's going to be really, really important to do the work to demand accountability, not just from a moral perspective. I think the people of the United States are going to need to kind of reckon with the legacy of that and do so in a very different way than this country has reckoned with some of its the legacies of some of the other atrocities that have been committed in this country. But we also need to think about it from a legal perspective and do that work of demanding accountability for a policy that legally meets the threshold for the definition of torture. And I think it's really, really important to call that policy what it is. And it does that in particular, not only because of the harm that it caused to those families, but because, and this is morally, I think, the most repugnant part, that was the explicit intent of that policy. The harm and trauma and loss was not a byproduct of another aim. It was, as Jeff Sessions told us, that was the point of the policy. So it's gonna be, I think, really important to address that in that way. And also that in this moment, we should be keeping that policy like front and center of our minds, because that's what's at stake, is more of that. And I think, you know, everybody on this call understands that. I'll speak really just real briefly to the question. There's a great question about the role of men in our organizing. And I want to just say you know, we tend to say and that men are critical allies in the fight for women's rights, but really men are not only critical allies, men are like, you know, comrades and colleagues and partners and brothers, like in this struggle, because this is not a struggle for one set of people and not another set of people. This is a struggle for human liberation, really, when we're talking about feminism, when we're talking about democracy. And in all of the grassroots organizations that MADRE supports, including the work of the women on this call, you know, there's not a practice of somehow like organizing women in a way that dislodges women from their families and from their communities, because it is their families and their communities as much as for themselves that women are fighting for. And so, so men and boys are a critical part of this work, and they are a critical part of the organizations themselves in many, many cases.
I I saw a question I would like to address. I saw the Black question about the Black Lives Matter and the frontline election defenders. And I think that, you know, observers, frontline defenders, and those different mechanisms are very, very important and should be there in this situation. But I also saw a question about if MADRE will reach Joe Biden and Jill and the vice president nominee, Kamala Harris is her name, to offer support if there is any election irregularities. Actually, I was thinking something that we have done here is use public support from different kind of government authorities, other countries, for instance, for the peace process and other elements here, other situations here. We go to different countries that had to do with that so they elevate their concerns and also the support. And I don't know if besides Jill, for instance, Biden, perhaps with some embassies, the ones that could be a little more outspoken, perhaps do some kind of outreach and lobby in terms of ask for their what is the word? So they can express concern if something happens, but it could be preventive in terms of expressing how they support democracy and this and that. So it's a way to kind of say that the world is watching, no? Mm-hmm. The other countries are watching. And so, you know, just announcements. I can find my words in English now, but.
No, I think we understand you. We understand you that this is a moment where the whole.
Exactly. Statements, you know, from women leaders and other countries, going to the embassies and say, you know, it will be important if you present a statement just calling for democracy and supporting and this or that, that they tell the message, leave the message that the world is watching and cares. I think those things.
Mm-hmm. I think, you know, it's interesting because in a moment where we're dealing with a national election, there's, you know, maybe a temptation to think of this as a US question, but I think this whole conversation and so much that we've seen in the past weeks and months have shown us that, as you know, not only are the eyes of the world on this election, but there's so much we can learn from the experiences of folks all over the world. So thank you once again to each of you as our speakers, to everyone who sent in questions. We tried to cover as many of them as possible. I'm not sure that we did, but this is just the beginning of the conversation. There'll be a lot more to say. And Joy, unfortunately, did have to step off since it's very late her time, but we would thank her as well. And I'll pass back to you, to Anika, to wrap us up.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody. And thank you for staying on this call. I just want to acknowledge the team at MADRE who, behind the scenes and some in front, who have helped put our event together. Of course, there's Yifat, who you saw, Diana, Shanda, Brittany, Akila, and Mariana. So thank you to that team. Thank you so much for all of our speakers and for all of you for standing with MADRE and believing in our work. It's great to have you on this important call. If you don't already know, I invite you to visit our website, MADRE's website, sign up for ways to be involved with MADRE, and please consider supporting us at this critical time. You will be receiving a follow-up email with a recording of this discussion. I know that question came up, and other materials that you can help and will help you activate others also. I want to just end with one of my favorite quotes, which is that nobody's free until everybody's free. I think that's a fundamental principle of feminist organizing. And I name that it is, of course, Fannie Lou Hammer's words and legacy that we all will try to live into. So thank you very much and goodbye for now. And know that you are always part of a much larger movement. We are not isolated. We are part of a collective movement for our collective liberation. Thank you.